Order, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please, Mrs. Meltzer.
Thank you. Trustee Matuzak.
Here.
Trustee Keys.
Here.
Trustee Patton.
Here.
Supervisor Cannon.
Here.
Trustee West.
Here.
Treasurer Gilliam.
Here.
Clerk Meltzer here.
Thank you. Approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Do you have any?
You say without objection.
Okay, without objection. Okay.
And I say.
Support?
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Treasurer Gilliam. Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes.
Thank you. And thank you all for being here this evening. I do have one public comment, actually, a PSA. The township, like every other group trying to hire, has a problem now with getting employees. So I'm putting out a plea, if you have young people who need a job and are willing to work hard and get a good background, we have plenty of jobs here at the township. We have Department of Public Services, we have Water and Sewer, Parks and Recreation, Senior Center. And these are all great jobs to put on your resume. So if you have somebody at home who's thinking about doing something but hasn't quite done it yet, please send them our way. We need them. And actually, having our background on their resume is not bad at all. So thank you. With that, we'll take the approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Support.
Thank you.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And the next item on our agenda is something that's special to a lot of people in our community, including myself. And that is the Families Against Narcotics. And all the judge is asking for tonight is permission to put up signs. I don't think you're asking for any money tonight yet, but if you do have a check, FAN is always looking for supporters. And it's a great organization. There's no one who's ever said anything bad about it. Judge, do you want, I know this is for the signs to go up around the township. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, I know that I really don't have to show up in person, but Clinton Township has been a huge supporter of us since the day that we started, which was 15 years ago. And we started right here in your backyard, and you guys really helped us grow. And most of our services, or a lot of them, happen in Clinton Township. And for the run, particularly, a lot of the citizens that walk in that are from the township. So right here's one of them. So we really have spread. I just, you know, I always like to give you an update of what we're doing. We have been honored by several police associations across America for the work that we do with community policing. Just in the last 2 months, I've been invited to 8 different states to highlight our programming, and they're looking to emulate what we do with our police programming. We have 5 different levels of programming. So if somebody comes in at Hope Not Handcuffs, which is our lowest level, and you guys have heard a lot about in the past, and they aren't doing well there, we can reach out to them and offer them a higher level of care, all the way up to 5 steps. And we're having tremendous success with programming as a result of that. In addition, since we got funded by the state, we work with 136 police departments across the state of Michigan, and 60 police departments in the state of New York are doing our Hope Not Handcuff program and are soon going to be starting our Comeback Quick Response Team program. We have won many awards for our programming, and it all started right here in your backyard. backyard. So I'm not here asking you for money, but I do know that you have opiate settlement money, and we have sent in a request for that. I hope you'll keep us in mind because we really serve a lot of citizens in Macomb County and in Clinton Township, and it would really be nice for you to show your appreciation with making us part of your list of where you will award that money. If you have any questions, I'm always glad to answer those, but...
Your 3 minutes is up, Judge.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay, I'm done.
Did you wish to speak?
I just want to say that in our own family...
To the microphone?
I'm sorry.
In our own family, we have someone who has used the services of FAN. It has meant a lot to me to see that my own sister is benefiting from that, and her family is indeed. And so I want to thank Linda for that, Judge, very much, because without FAN, Rita would be floundering on how to help her family. So I walk every year if I can, because I can't run. Let's put it that way. I can't run, but I do walk the 5K. So thank you.
There's a lot of us who walk instead of run anymore. Thank you, Judge Davis. I was with you when you started, and I know exactly what you went through, as did many families. I don't think there's a problem with the signs. If there is a motion to approve.
Mr. Cannon, could we just get an announcement as to the date and time of the event?
Okay.
And location? Well, it is, but I didn't get it.
It's June 17th, and the actual walk takes place at Fraser High School, but we put up a number of signs in the township. We do get permission from every owner of property before we put it up. We never just put it up in empty fields. We always get permission, and we take them down within 3 days of the run. So we put them up about a month before, and then they are down within usually 72 hours after the run ends.
Well, that's smart because you save them for next year.
That's right. Okay.
I'll make a motion, Mr. Kent. Oh.
If I could, I just want to say, Judge, thank you. As a graduate of Fraser High School, I was able to see the impact, but also the presence that you have in our schools. And also a couple of years ago, I had the fortune to volunteer to put up the signs that the families bring in the day of that go up at the tent at Fraser High School. And that really had an impact on me, seeing how many families in our community have been impacted. And that really stuck with me. So thank you.
Come back and see how that's grown. It'll break your heart.
Thank you for being here tonight.
Yeah, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you, Mr. Keyes.
Yeah, I'll support Ms. Patton's motion.
Thank you. I would just add, there is no family that hasn't been affected in one way or another. Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 3, resolution for Arab American Heritage Month.
Mr. Cannon, the petitioner is here if she'd like to speak, and she's been here in the past.
You already spoke.
Well, she spoke
okay,
on another
all right.
issue.
On an entirely different subject.
Okay.
And it's to express the gratitude of the Arab Americans who live, work, and play in Clinton Township for this recognition. We are in Michigan, the greatest concentration of Arab Americans outside the Middle East here in Michigan of over 500,000 people. And we don't have a census because we're not on the census as a minority group, but there are many people in Clinton Township who really love it here, work here, play here. And I want to thank you and for recognizing this as April as April Arab American Heritage Month, and hope that we can do it again next year.
I'm sure
but
we
thank
can.
You very kindly.
Thank you. And thank you for being here. So you get 2 3-minute speeches.
Yeah, there you go. I'll make a motion.
I'm teasing.
I'll make a motion.
I'll
second
that.
Second.
Supported by, I don't know who was first.
Go ahead. Give it.
You can
give
it.
Give it to Kim.
Mrs. Meltzer.
Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Trustee West.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam.
Yes.
Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you. Item 4, a request approval recognizing April as 9/11 Operator Appreciation Month in Clinton Township. Mrs. Patton, is this something that's nationwide or is that just here?
It's nationwide only for the week of April 5th through the, April 9th through the 15th.
And
go ahead.
I know that you have a very close association with our public safety departments.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you brought this forward, so I appreciate that very much.
Thank you.
So, Mrs. Meltzer, are you going to read the entire resolution, or do you want to just have...
You want me to...
Oh,
you
want
me to read it? Okay, yes. Okay. At a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees of the Charter Township of Clinton, held in the board chambers on the 24th day of April 2023, whereas nationwide over 35,911 operators are presently engaged in the occupation of furnishing immediate first responder assistance in crisis situations to the public at large. And whereas nationwide, 77.8% of 9/11 operators are women, while 22.2% are men. Whereas 9/11 operators are consummate professionals who have received extensive training and have exhibited both intelligence and emotional stability in order to successfully perform an extraordinarily difficult task under extreme stress. Whereas it is well documented that the constant crisis of performing as a 9/11 operator takes an emotional toll upon 9/11 operators, resulting in a multitude of stress-related issues. Whereas it has been documented nationwide that the average 9/11 operator will take over 2,480 calls in a calendar year. Whereas at the federal level, the week of April 9th through April 15th has been previously declared as National Public Safety Telecommunication Week, honoring 9/11 operators. And whereas the Board of Trustees in the Charter Township of Clinton wishes to increase public awareness of the dedication, professionalism, and sacrifice made on behalf of the public at large by 9/11 operators. Therefore, by motion and support, it is hereby ordered and declared that the month of April in each year shall be deemed as 9/11 Operator Appreciation Month in the Charter Township of Clinton in order to give proper recognition, deserved appreciation, and increase public awareness of the performance of 9/11 operators who daily in their jobs meet the challenges faced as true first responders, providing care, comfort, and protection to the general public.
Yes. Thank you. We have four. I recognize only one of you, but luckily I don't recognize your voices because I haven't called 911. But when they're done, Chief, I want you to talk about what we're going to do later in the fall, honoring them also here in Clinton Township at the center. You have the floor, ma'am.
Hey, good evening. I'm Angela Elsie, the dispatch director for the Sheriff's Office. With me, I have Elizabeth Vegas, our operations manager, and two of our public safety professionals, Rex Smoltz and Jacob Franklin. Those are the voices on the other end of the phone that you hear. Really appreciate Trustee Patton you introducing this resolution, and if it passes, the support of the board as well. We have a very good supportive relationship with our police and fire department here in Clinton Township. We're very thankful to serve the citizens of Clinton Township. Those were quite impressive statistics that you were able to find. And you know, statewide, there's only 2,200 of us in the state of Michigan for a population of nearly 10 million. So a very small group of people that have dedicated their lives to serving the community and answering 911 calls. I am very proud to say that our dispatch center at the ComTech building that services the Sheriff's Office, Clinton Township, Sterling Heights, and many communities for fire service as well, handles on average about 400,000 calls in a year. So we have about the third highest call volume out of 137 dispatch centers in the state of Michigan. So we have a very, very dedicated group of professionals, and we are very lucky to have them. We put in a lot of training into them to make sure that our citizens receive the best response that they can. This resolution means a lot to us, especially at this time. There is such big movement for a federal reclassification of 911 operators as public safety first responders. Even though in Michigan there's not a true definition that would need to be amended or preventing our dispatchers from receiving any type of benefit that exists for other first responders, nationally there is. And there are many public safety telecommunicators that don't have access to certain benefits, mental health and wellness training, different funding, or even retirement benefits. So that's an active initiative that many of us are working with our legislators here and calling on some congressional support for. So this comes at a perfect time to show your recognition and appreciation at a time where they're watching. And it really means a lot to them to have the support. So we appreciate you all, and thank you very much.
Thank you for bringing it forward.
Thank you,
Mrs. Patton.
Thank you.
Chief, could you please talk a little bit about what's coming up later in the fall? And we're including police, fire, EMS, and dispatchers, I think for the first time.
Yes. You made me have to look up the date because I didn't want to.
I gave you a warning.
So National First Responders Day is October 28th. So we had gotten together with the fire department and MedStar, and including our dispatchers as well. And we want to put together a nice event to recognize some of those that go above and beyond with different kind of recognition. And it's hard to quantify that because they do such tremendous work on a daily basis. So with fire department and MedStar services and our command staff, we're going to put together a little award ceremony, invite everybody at a venue where a space is not limited, and we can hopefully recognize these men and women for all the hard work that they do on a daily basis.
They do.
Yes.
I couldn't do what you do, so thank you. Gentlemen, I think I know you from Walmart or someplace. I don't know.
You know him because he was at the fire department. He received an award for helping father with the heart attack. He kept keep him alive until they got there.
Yes.
So that's how you know him.
I do.
And I want to make a motion for approval for this resolution, but I also want to say something.
Yes.
Because I really appreciate what you all do. And I'm not just saying that as a cliche. You know that I'm down there. I've toured. I've come to the training. It means a lot to me. And a lot of people don't see the first responders behind the scenes. And you guys are absolutely the first responders. I've had to call in the past, and I was thankful for the person I got on the other end, because a frantic issue turned into a very calm one when somebody on the other end is calm and they can walk you through something. So our residents benefit profusely for your services, your team as a whole. And I just really want to say I appreciate that. I looked and I said, okay, nationally, it's 9th through the 15th, but Clinton Township should give you more. You are owed more than that. So that's why I wanted to make the rest of April, the whole April, have it observed for you guys. So thank you, all of you.
Thank you, Mrs. Patton.
Yes.
And truly, we're glad you're there every single day.
Yes.
I'll second that motion.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
People can bring you donuts.
Oh, I'm sorry.
just one thing.
Of course.
It may seem like a small thing. When our clerk read the resolution, she talked about 9/11. It's really critical in the emergency response world that we always talk about 911. It's how children learn to dial the phone. It's how, in a moment of emergency, people are looking for an 11 on their phone. So it's really critical we all say 911 when referring to emergency services. This is a small
thing.
No, it's not a small thing.
That's fine. That's a good point.
Yeah. Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 5, approve resolution in recognition of Workers' Memorial Day proclamation and resolution.
I believe Mr. Keyes, did you bring this forward?
Myself, Treasurer Gillingham, and Trustee Matuzak.
Were you guys
the resolutions
to speak to it, or did you want me to read it?
If you could read it, please.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Whereas every year on April 28th, communities and work sites around the world honor friends, family members, and colleagues who have been killed or injured on the job. Whereas in 2021, the Federal Bureau of Labor Statistics estimated that 5,190 workers were killed by traumatic injuries on the job. On average, nearly 100 workers died every week at roughly 14 workplace deaths a day. Whereas in 2021, 140 workers were lost through fatal workplace accidents in Michigan, and whereas it is appropriate to honor the memory of the courageous and dedicated members of Michigan's labor force who have been injured or disabled or have died as a result of workplace accidents. Whereas we remember those who have died in workplace catastrophes, suffered occupational-related diseases, or have been injured due to dangerous conditions. Whereas recognition of the integrity of Michigan's workforce and its achievements on behalf of the economic growth of our state is necessary, and whereas the Clinton Township Board wishes to pay tribute to the workers who have died or been injured or disabled in workplace accidents, we honor the contribution of Michigan's workforce and call for increased workplace safety. Whereas the Clinton Township Board renews our efforts to seek stronger workplace safety and health protections, better standards and enforcement, and fair and just compensation, and by rededicating ourselves to improving safety and health in every city workplace. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Clinton Township Board that by its members, this board declare April 28th, 2023, as Workers' Memorial Day in the Clinton Township, Michigan.
Thank you. Mr. Keyes, did you wish to speak?
No. Thank you, Mr. Cannon.
Mr. Gillham.
Thank you, Mr. Cannon. So while we're here with our first responders, I think about the connection between these two issues, right? You know, you're the folks that get the call when something like this happens. In the state of Michigan so far this year, there have been 8 workplace deaths so far, according to MSHDA, not MSHDA, MIOSHA. I just want to go through just, you know, kind of give a snapshot here of some of these tragedies that have occurred. On January 4th, a 57-year-old truck driver was making a delivery in a concrete truck, became stuck on the job site. A contractor using a bulldozer to tow by a cable to pull the truck out. The hitch pin on the bulldozer failed. The tow cable snapped back, went through the windshield, killed him. January 23rd, a 54-year-old truck driver was kneeling over a single-pierced rim wheel and tire. The assembly exploded. The tire burst from sidewall damage and struck the person blowing up the tire. It's countless stories. 28-year-old firefighter responding to a call of a broken tree branch hanging over a power line. They got the workplace secured. Everything was, they thought, in order. Another power line snap killed them instantly. Van Buren County on March 3rd, road worker was part of a 4-man crew doing the traffic. We see those folks with the signs out there, hit and killed. A garbage truck rear-ended with the worker right behind it, smashed between those two vehicles. 39-year-old emergency medical technician was driving an ambulance. So EMTs, fatally struck by an oncoming vehicle. Electrician, maintenance journeyman, so somebody with a lot of experience on the job, but multi-person crew, struck by a radiator assembly during the dismantlement, a transformer, electrical substation blew, killed them instantly. These are the types of tragedies that occur on the workplace. And so we need to make sure that we don't erode worker safety standards within the state of Michigan. This is a bold statement, I think, from the township to say these folks who work hard, work with their hands, work on the job, work in dangerous situations, regardless of their profession, they need to have the protections that are in place by the state, and we need to make sure we strengthen those. So,
thank you.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Just to add to that, we often don't, or when we think of workplace tragedies, we're thinking of electricians and mechanics and our first responders, traffic people. But the reality is that we, as an employer, we employ many people in this township. And it's up to us to also make sure that our workers are protected and have a safe environment, safe from chemicals, safe from heavy equipment, all of the sorts of things we do. And in my short time on the board, I'm happy to say that I have heard our employee safety be a priority in many parts of our discussions. And I think it's imperative, whether we're an employer, as the township is, or a private employer, that we all take worker safety very seriously, because as Mr. Gillham pointed out, people are injured, and their life has changed forever. So,
and their families are too, and so
exactly.
Is the community. And
exactly.
I'm glad to say that you've heard that we do take many precautions here in the community, and we do. And we will continue to do so, because we've got people out there working on the roads, we're working on sewer lines, water lines. Sometimes people are mad because Garfield's down to one lane because we're redoing sewers. That's for their own benefit. So watch out for the people in orange, please.
Exactly.
All set? Roll call, please.
No, we need a motion.
I thought you did.
Support.
Mm-hmm. Roll call, please.
So,
motion by Mr. Keyes,
okay.
Supported by Mrs. Patton.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gillham.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
These things might seem trite, but to us as elected officials in the community and to those who are affected and their families who are affected, it's important to us. And even though it may not mean a lot that we're doing this tonight, at least we can show that we care, and we do care. So thank you. With that, item six, introduction of applicants seeking reappointment to the Prince Drury Park Advisory Committee.
Dear board members, there are currently 10 openings on the Prince Drury Park Advisory Committee. The terms are for 2 years and will expire on June 30th, 2025. Attached for your review are two applications for appointment from the following applicants. These are reappointments, Brianna McBride and Kiana Dorsey. Per the policy guidelines, an invitation has been extended to these applicants to attend the April 24th, 2023 board meeting, whereby they will be given 3 minutes to introduce themselves to the Board of Trustees. Thank you for your attention in this matter. Sincerely, Robert Cannon, Supervisor.
Thank you. Is anyone here who wishes to speak? I would recommend to the board that we reappoint these two to the committee this evening.
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item seven, revision to resolution creating the Inclusive Playground Committee.
Dear Honorable Board of Trustees, you know the Clinton Township Inclusive Playground Committee was created by resolution of the Board of Trustees with the mission to build an inclusive playground and advise the township on exclusivity in our parks. By way of an update, fundraising efforts have now surpassed the six-figure mark, and we are actively competing for grant, foundation, and state funding. The committee is blessed with a core group of active members who share and have worked to advance the mission. We are also thankful for the contributions of those members who have served and helped but stepped away due to other competing interests. In order to maintain a full complement of active members, we are looking for a small change in the resolution, allowing us to widen the field of qualified applicants to the Board of Trustees. Specifically, please see the proposed language in bold proposed in the second from last paragraph. Be it further resolved that the IPC will have not less than 7 or more than 13 members comprised of at least 2 representatives of the township and citizens who either live in Clinton Township, work for an organization with a physical presence in Clinton Township, or individuals dedicated to the successful implementation of an inclusive playground for individuals of all abilities in Clinton Township. And the Inclusive Playground Committee currently has 3 vacancies posted and believe this change would allow us to better meet our mission to the township. Respectfully, Paul Gilliam, Treasurer and member of the Inclusive Playground Committee.
Thank you. And I've had an opportunity to speak with Mr. Gilliam, and I believe this would allow us to add to the committee that would maybe add funds to the committee and add amenities that we may not get otherwise. So I would be in full support of this. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 8, request board approval for a temporary outdoor patio at 36450 Moravian.
I'm requesting to be placed on the April 24th, 2023 agenda for approval from the Board of Trustees to build a temporary outdoor patio, allowing patrons to enjoy our great food, drinks, and hospitality. And this is the Sajos at Moravian and Garfield area.
Thank you. Now, this would be for a temporary 6-month approval, and they would have to come back for either an additional 6 months later or a permanent approval. They did this during the COVID problem, and it worked out very well. So I'm thinking it will be this. It was the same location. They need to put up barriers to make sure that there are no cars that would come crashing through for the patrons who would be sitting outside enjoying the weather.
I'll make a motion for approval.
Thank you.
I'll support that.
Thank you, Mrs. West.
Mr. Cannon, before I wanted to read that Mr. Miller, our building director, said he has spoken to Alphonse and he forwarded the attached. He's good with the proposal and he's agreed to work with building and fire for any needs for life safety, including proper vehicle protection, while he pursues a permanent outdoor area for his patrons.
Thank you. So,
and he is here too, in case he wants to speak on this.
I don't think there's any questions. You've done it before and it worked out. I'm surprised that you took it down, but you did, so now you're back before us.
I didn't know they did it before.
They had one.
They did? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You had one outside before?
Under different ownership.
Yeah, same place.
Yeah, okay.
Same concept.
And who made the motion and seconded that? I'm sorry.
Ms. Patton, supported by Ms. West.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Gilliam?
And if we could clarify that the motion is to approve contingent upon approval from the building department and the fire department to ensure that the necessary safeguards are in place.
That's correct. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, so I support that still.
Me too.
I don't think they'd go anywhere without that, but that's, no. That's good. Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 9, request board approval for a Class C quota liquor license for Garfield Road, also known as Vincent Joe's.
Dear board members, applicant Vincent Joe's Fruit Market, Inc., located at 41790 Garfield Road, Clinton Township, Michigan, 48038, is requesting your approval of ownership for one of the remaining four Class C quota liquor licenses. Vincent Joe Fruit Market, Inc. has successfully fulfilled the requirements per the Building Department and Fire Department, as well as the police background check, payment of the application fees, and any outstanding township fees necessary to acquire this request. Thank you for your attention to this matter. Sincerely, Kim Meltzer, Clerk. Mr. Cannon, also, they sent an additional information, a site plan diagram showing where they plan to host all of this for their customers, and then also a really nice letter, which I don't know if you're going to read, but you're welcome to read it, or if you want me to, or if you just want to speak to it, that's fine too. Letting us know how much they plan to invest in everything they've done for our community so far, which is a lot, by the way.
It is. Mm-hmm. This young man, I used to see running around the store when you were this tall.
Long time.
Taking care of business. Vincent Joe's has been here for quite some time, and they keep expanding a little at a time, carefully, and every time they do, it gets better and better for our community. Typically, Mr. Gilliam and I talked about this, I don't know, today or yesterday or whenever, we try to give these licenses out to people who are coming new to the community who need a break. These people have done so much for the community, they don't need a break. They're still gonna do what they're gonna do, except this would allow us as consumers to sample new wines that they might have. This is going to allow people to come into their store like they do in many upscale communities and have a glass of wine and walk around and taste and see what they have as far as the meats and cheeses and new wines. Now, I know they will still be in business if we don't give them this license, but I think they will be in a better shape if we do give it to them. And they've never said no to Parks and Rec, to our senior center, to our seniors, to our police department who request donations for events that we hold in our community. They have never, to my knowledge, said no. And I hope we don't say no tonight.
I'll make a motion for approval.
Thank I'll you. Second that motion.
No, it's open. The floor is open for discussion. Typically, we would say, you are who? Vince who? Mm. Well, we know who you are, and we know what you are, and we appreciate what you are.
Julie,
I mean, you've got a motion on the floor and a support.
Julie.
I'm sorry, Ms. Jerry. You will have ample opportunity to speak. So
I assume they might speak first.
Well, the only thing is they're going to try to sell us on this, and I'm already sold on it.
Let's give them the opportunity.
Yeah. Everybody knows Vincent Joe's. Sir, do you wish?
I would.
Give us your name and address.
My name is
please.
Seth Tompkins. I'm an attorney. I've been doing liquor licensing work for 22 years over the state, all over the state. And I've done work with many different grocery stores and many different municipalities. And before I go and tell all of you what you already know about Vincent Joe's, wanted to say how lovely it was to work with Kim on this, and that I've enjoyed working with this particular municipality. I've also enjoyed meeting Vince and his parents and his aunt and uncle and learning about the family and the business and knowing that this business has been in this community for 40 years and is a real pillar of the community. Not only is it known around greater Clinton Township area and Macomb County, but this is one of these types of grocery stores that I live, I live in West Bloomfield and I work in Southfield, and I know Vincent Joe's. Everybody knows Vincent Joe's. So I did want to point out a couple things that you may or may not know. This is, you know, they've got two stores. And so their other store that they operate already does have a Class C license, and they've incorporated that wonderfully with the business. That they're excellent operators with respect to following the rules and regulations of both the municipality and the state with respect to alcohol service. And so you know that you have someone that you can count on to do the right thing with this liquor license. You also know that because they've been here for 40 years that they're not going anywhere. This isn't a restaurant that you are going to take a chance on, and there's a distinct possibility that they might be closed in 3 to 5 years. So the supervisor discussed the different municipal organizations that Vincent Joe's gives to, but it also gives to local food banks, and even I found out when I was introduced to the judge is a supporter of FAN as well. So this is a true community organization. They've been a supporter of your community for 40 years, and we are just asking that you support them, that these quota licenses only come around once every 10 years, and it would help Vince and his family do here what they're already doing in their other establishment. And I don't know if any of the board has had a chance to actually read the letter that was put together by Vince, but they do have ideas of how to use this. They've just recently renovated the store and included a pizza counter where they have pizza and hot sandwiches, and so this is kind of an extension of that. They want to expand that area to allow seating so that someone who comes in can have a glass of wine, read the paper, have some pizza. That's okay, that happens. And they want to have, and there's also on the drawings that we gave to you, there's an area in the wine section where the shelving is all on wheels, so you can move it out of the way. They can put seating there, and they can have wine dinners, and that's their plan, to have regular wine dinners, to have regular seating at the pizzeria, to have occasional store-wide events where they would welcome people to walk around with a glass of wine. That's not something that I don't think is, well, I know that this happens in Papa Joe's and it happens in Plum Market over on the west side. I don't know if that's something that you guys even envisioned, but they also do these outdoor festivals where they do temporary outdoor service. You get that through both city approval and state approval for liquor control. And then they can have these outdoor festivals where they have a beer tent or something like that. So
I don't think you have room for a beer tent over there.
Not right now.
Anyways, that if anyone has any like questions for me about process, I can help you. But as far as operations, this is the man you have to talk to.
That's not going to be your main source of revenue. I can guarantee you that. That's simply something on top of everything else you do.
Yes. And I'm Vince Vitale from Vincent Joe's. And like Mr. Cannon said, I've been there since a little kid, you know, and I've watched my dad and my uncle start this beautiful business from, I believe it was 13 employees to over 150 now. And over the years, you know, kids from schools working there and families growing. It's just, I really love Clinton Township. It's like I grew up here. You know, I don't live in Clinton Township right now, but I'm here every day, you know, and I have my other store, which I live closer to, but I love coming here. I love seeing these people. It's like family. You know, I recognize some of you, and we just want to grow and stay competitive because this market is so tough, and like the Costco's and these markets, they're always trying to one up, do better. So we want Vincent Joe's to be that store. Like, I know we can't always be the cheapest because we can't buy like these big box stores, but when you have fresh produce, great service, these niche things, it makes people want to say, oh my God, I'm in Clinton Township. I got to go to Vincent Joe's. I mean, I have to.
The desserts,
everything, you know, it's just, and it's something great. And like you said, you know, it's obviously not a make or break for us, but it's always something where I love to keep growing this store and employ more people. You know, this summer we're hiring 20 more people just because we're going to get busier. And I love being a part of it, and I love being in Clinton Township.
The other thing I didn't mention is you were concerned at the gas station on the corner.
Yes,
and you
yes.
came to us, and you helped us get things changed over there because it was falling apart.
Yes,
it's
correct.
Beautiful now.
Yes, it looks great. And that's what I love. I love when there's improvements in the area because, you know, Clinton Township's beautiful, and just little couple makeup yeah. things and making it look great, it just helps everybody.
Thank you. Are there any questions, Julie?
Not a question so much. I love Vincent Joe's.
Thank you.
Spend a lot of time there. Eat a lot of food from there.
It's right down the street from you.
It's right down the street from me. And I have complete trust that you will use this liquor license appropriately. And I'm going to vote for this. But I have to say my concern is that the purpose of these types of liquor licenses is to help new businesses. And we have four left. After this one, there'll be three left until we get our next allocation of them whenever that happens. And that concerns me. You guys are a great business, an established business. You get all my business.
Sure.
But that does bother me that we're giving up one of these licenses when I would hope we would be using them to attract new businesses and to, you know, keep developing this great place, which is a great place to live in. I think there are lots of small, young entrepreneurs who are trying to start out, and this would really be a break for them. I'm going to vote for this, but I wanted to express my reservations. We have three left after this. I hope that we spend them wisely.
I totally agree with you. And I'm not disagreeing with anything that you said at all, but there is no line at the door to get these licenses. There are many lawsuits now. There are many problems with having a liquor license. And I know Mrs. Meltzer has been, she's like guarding them like eggs over there. And as we should as a board. And Mr. Gillingham and I talked about this recently too. In fact, Friday. We want new businesses to come to our community and open up and be a Vincent Joe's. But here we have a Vincent Joe's who's here already who can be a little bit better. So that's my reason for supporting them. Plus,
Mr. Cannon,
what they do for the community.
Mr. Cannon, I just wanted to clarify. My understanding of these liquor licenses is that they belong to the state of Michigan and that they are given to communities for economic development. Well, I don't think they were given to us to help necessarily a small business or a struggling business. They are actually tools to help with economic development. And this, I can't think of a better company to help with economic development and what they plan to do with this license than what Vincent Joe's is proposing. This truly is an economic development tool that you're going to utilize that's going to continue to service this community. So to me, this is the best example of why we would want to give an on-premise Class C liquor license to allow people to experience another type of service or experience in our community. And what better place to do it than Vincent Joe's? We all go there, we love it. It's a great opportunity, not just for economic development, but for health development. I am so grateful that we have not one, not two, but three amazing produce stores and meat stores in our community that keep us healthy. Those are choices that there's no excuse for us not to be healthy.
Except for transportation.
And so it's very, this is a great example of economic development, and I'm very much in support. As I said, I seconded or supported the motion. I look forward to supporting this and getting this passed so that I can come to your store and grab a Cabernet while I'm shopping.
Well, what I'm looking for is your children running around who are going to take over for you someday because it's going to be here forever.
Yes.
Further discussion, Mr. Gillingham?
So as Mr. Cannon said, we had somewhat of a discussion on this. I'm a Vincent Joe's fan. I live in Clinton Township. Spend a lot of money in your store. Give me alcohol while I'm shopping. I'll probably spend more. Which is
he knows that
to the application here. So I do want to go through the sort of purpose of this in the plan.
Sure.
So the pizza counter. You have a pizza counter now. You've made a significant investment in that store.
Yes.
You widened it, made it larger. You've put in a sort of cafe area, if you will.
Yep.
I don't think this is going to generate a whole lot of revenue for you, as Mr. Cannon said. So it's not going to be the sort of economic driver that the state awards these to us for. But I think it's a nice element. So I'm like, why do you want to have this? And let me rephrase the question, sure. I think, a little bit more. You can buy a liquor license. And I know you guys can afford a liquor license. They have them all the time. You can transfer them.
Sure.
Going rate anywhere, the attorney could probably speak to that better than I can. But last time I saw a transfer was like $25,000 to $30,000.
More than that.
I guess let's start there, sir.
Presently, right now, Macomb County liquor licenses, I think, going for Class C liquor licenses, going for $65,000. That's okay. The going rate for a liquor license. However, I do know that, you know, I believe that this township has awarded quota licenses to other large companies. I think Red Robin received a quota license from you guys.
Red, blast from the past, right?
Well, I mean, they make, I checked, they did almost $500 million in revenue last year. And so, and if you look at the difference between an organization like that, where yes, they employ a lot of high school students and there will be a manager there that might be able to support a family working there. I mean, compared to Vincent Joe's, which has 150 employees right now, plans on hiring 20 more. Yep. And so you ask, like, what is the purpose of it? And the purpose is to support this business that supports the community and supports so many families that live and work in this community. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, yeah, it's not gonna make them $1 million where right. it's not generating revenue for them, but it will generate more foot traffic. It will generate more revenue. It will generate more people coming in at different times during the day for different reasons, you know? And so it's the same reason why, you know, does any gas station truly need a liquor license to sell it? No, but it's a value add. People go there and it's one less thing that they have to do. While they're there, they might be able to have a drink, and they might be able to then after go and have shopping. You know, go there with the family, have some pizza, sit down, and then go grocery shopping. Okay. You know, or as Vince put in the letter that he submitted, these wine events. You know, and you have to realize that those are value add, right? So while someone might go to a wine event, let's say they have you're hosting a wine event for 30 couples to come in and have a wine pairing. Sure, that wine dinner is only gonna make so much money, right? But everyone there might leave with a half case of one of the
You're getting close to your 3 minutes.
Anyways, it's.
And I just wanted to add one more thing. I apologize for the long time, but like you were saying that Vincent Joe's is a great company, but even up until we did a remodel, you know, for a good year and a half, we were losing customers every week. And that can be from just so much competition. And, you know, when I'd go home at night and I wouldn't be able to sleep because I'm so nervous. I'm like this, my father and my uncle gave me this company, you know, to run and grow, and it's eating me alive. And I felt like I had to do something. And obviously we did this major remodel that cost over $2 million, you know, and, you know, I think every day I got to do the best we can to keep this growing, you know, and, you know, take care of all these families that work there. And what do we do to improve? People love coming in the store. Oh my God, this is new. That's a huge thing. You know, even after a couple of years, you know, customers, oh wow, they haven't improved. You know, they could lose interest really quick. And you know, speaking to my cousin Salvo at our Shelby store, that license does great from the, you know, the wine tastings, the dinners, the, you know, people coming in for lunch and doing classes. They team up with Boar's Head and do like a charcuterie board. There's endless possibilities. And we just want to, it's not about the money, but it's just increasing the experience and helping us grow and continue to grow and employ more people and maybe expand somewhere in there. I'm not sure where, but, you know, that's our goal, you know, and keeping a great company in this community.
This is kind of the point that I'm trying to make here, and that is that this is Clinton Township. Like I said, you can buy one of these on the market.
Yes.
But this is a free liquor license. So this is the township awarding this to your company. In a sense, it's a public, you know, benefit to a private company.
Sure.
So I think what I'm trying to get at and what I want to make sure that the public understands, because I think this is going to pass and I'm going to vote for it. I'm going to support it. But I want to make sure that we communicate, how is this going to affect the community at large?
Because that's what he just told you.
Public benefit. Yeah. And I understand. I understand he told me that, but I'm sort of clarifying the purpose
of the
question.
Say it again, then. Say the same thing again.
I don't need you to say it again. What I'm saying is, I think you've answered the question, but I want to understand, make sure that we all put it in the proper context. This is a public investment into Vincent Joe's.
Yes, and Mr. Cannon. I understand that point. I want to know that the Vitale family is invested in Clinton Township, and that's what we did with this big remodel. And we want to be a staple in this community.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping with your help, you know, obviously with this large amount of money we spent, you know, obviously, you know, we could use any support and we want to just keep growing. And that's what I believe, you know, we're here for, and we want to.
So we're getting there in sort of the roundabout way. You have made a significant investment in the store, $2 million to upgrade the store, make it nicer, make it more competitive, make it a wider, because sometimes it's tough to navigate.
Sure, sure.
So
it's not roundabout, like I said, it's very direct.
Like I said, I go there.
No, I understand.
This is one of my favorite places to go and shop. But I think you've hit the nail on the head. You're making a public investment. You're trying to make it nicer. You're trying to create experiences. That's going to be a benefit to you. I want to make sure that we make that as a benefit to the community at large.
Of course.
Okay.
All right. Mrs. Patton, you have the floor.
Mine is more just technical. So I keep hearing you guys saying you're going to hire 20 more individuals. Is that for this store over here in Clinton Township?
Yes.
Okay, and what age do you start at?
We start at 15.
At 15?
Yes.
And have you guys ever done the numbers to determine how many people actually live in Clinton Township that you're hiring, that you actually have working for your store?
I'm not sure I don't believe so, but I know of a lot of people, obviously, when we see resumes and applications and hiring, there's a good majority from this area, yes. But exact specific numbers, I don't have that, no.
I see a lot of his employees in church.
Mm-hmm. That's kind of my point, too. So that goes to diversity.
Yes.
So when I walk in, I don't see a lot of diversity, and I'm just, that's why I'm asking, too.
Sure.
So how do you include that? Because there's so many children around here that go to Clintondale, they go to Chippewa, and it's so diverse. So,
sure.
But I don't see those students in that store. So, but I do see other students in that store.
I mean, we try to promote jobs through different avenues, main things, you know, like Facebook or, you know, our website, in-store advertising. I mean, we obviously try to watch our budget in terms of hiring. Sometimes it's not the greatest of luck that we have with a lot of applicants coming in, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, we're open to anything. We want to hire anybody that's willing to work and willing to try to work. And obviously, if you guys know any avenues of, hey, you know, try this person or this school, they need people. I mean, we need lots of people right now. And, you know, obviously it's not like a Google. A lot of our employees are more older people and they're getting ready to retire. So we're always looking for young, new people. Yeah.
And you heard my public service announcement at the beginning. We can't find enough people to work part-time for DPW, Water and Sewer, and Parks and Rec here in Clinton Township. Rick Iceberg told me he can't find enough people to work at Barrymore's, a place that used to have people lined up to work at. Mm-hmm. I mean, I agree with you. We need diversity no matter what. And I've never paid attention. My wife does all the shopping.
I pay attention.
Well,
we don't need just diversity on paperwork. I mean, we always hear that and see it and read it, that, oh, we're trying to be diverse. I see that on paper, but I don't ever see it in the actual dynamics, and that's what gets me. So I've walked in there several times, and I know several students that have applied, and I whatever reason, they weren't hired. But I know some of their friends were, and there was a difference. It was an obvious difference. So that's why I was asking.
Well,
that's a conversation we can have.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Thank you. First of all, you know I love your store.
You've seen me.
Yes. The only question that I have is your parking lot is small.
Yes.
And I have been hit, personally hit, not car hit, in the parking lot by a car 3 times. And I'm like,
geez.
Yeah. Luckily, I already have bad knees, so it's just like, whatever. I mean, I can't do anything about that. But that's my fear, because it is very small. Have you ever looked at how you can, could you have a valet? Could you have a, you know, that they pick up the phone?
Well, no, look,
just listen, please. Other people were able to talk, okay?
I understand.
Please. have you looked at that? Because I, obviously, I'm still going to be at the store, and I'm going to be walking around with my glass of wine and spending a lot more money, right? But no, thank you for doing what you've done. And the people that you've hired to go ahead and do the work at that store are extremely nice. And in fact, the other day I was trying to reach something on the top shelf and the guy came over, handed it to me. I was like, thank you. So I appreciate what you've done over there.
No problem. And I appreciate you always coming in the store. I mean, I love seeing you there. And obviously right now our parking lot is to code, but we do notice, you know, because we're growing, we're hiring more people. You know, I've spoken with my father. We're, you know, in the, obviously this year we're kind of spent a lot of money. So we're trying to really think of what we could do, but we're thinking something maybe in our back parking lot. We have this big mound where we could possibly remove that and add about, I think, 12 to 14 more spots, which I know doesn't sound like a lot, but that would help tremendously, yes. You know? So obviously we're going to look into that for sure. We want to resurface our whole parking lot, make it look nice and beautiful. So there is some things we're going to work on. And obviously that's a big thing too, where we would love to come up with ideas. I mean, some people have said put a second deck in our parking lot, but that's not feasible, obviously. So, but we do have incentives for employees to carpool. If they do that, they get a gift card every week. So there's a couple things we do, but obviously most people prefer to drive themselves and just go home after that instead of being in a car with a coworker, you know, on the way home. So,
right. Well, think about it. And
absolutely.
If you
absolutely
want to run anything by me, let me know.
I will. Thank you.
I'm done.
Okay. Mr. Keyes?
Thank you. I'm going to skip the I love Vince disclaimer that we had to, each board member had to do, even though I do love the store. I do love the store. I try to go to the farmer's market on Gratiot as much as I can, actually, though. But Vince and Joe's is amazing. And to bring us back a little bit to, you know, the reality of what Mr. Gillingham was saying, and I think Trustee Matuzak, and something I really appreciate is if you're standing or you're living at 16 in Grosbec, finding fresh produce isn't as easy as we're talking about. So people that live there hearing about the idea of getting wine and valets at grocery, they're just looking for an open quality grocery store, sure, that they can get to with the lack of transportation or income that they may be experiencing. And that's not a problem for you to fix. I think that, again, though, the questions that Mr. Gillingham asked and the answers that you gave us really good answers to be able to say to our constituents that drive up and down Gratiot and Grosbec and see the vacant buildings, an answer to why we're picking one of the tools up out of the shelf for economic development and using it in this case. So I think you've given us a lot of great answers. And I hope that the administration and the board takes a good reflection and says, we have three more of these. How can we fill one of those places on Grosbec or Gratiot that we all know could really use a quality grocery store? So again, I plan on voting yes on this. I think it's going to pass, but I really do appreciate the time that we've spent talking about how you would qualify for this, why it would benefit the community, to give me those answers to the residents when they start asking. Thank you, Mr. Cannon.
Thank you for the extra time.
Yeah. Roll call, please.
Thank you. Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Good luck.
I look forward to talking to you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. See you guys. Thank you.
Sanitary sewer pump station generator purchase.
Dear Honorable Board of Trustees, on April 13th, 2023, the Budget Ways and Means Committee met and discussed the direct purchase by the Township of three Kohler generators for installation at sewer pump stations listed on the attached memorandum. The impetus for the direct purchase of the desired equipment and brand is based on a competitive quote, additional savings by utilizing the Township's sales tax exemption status and anticipated backlog of 60 weeks from the time of purchase to delivery. DPS familiarity with the equipment, along with Kohler record of reliability and prompt service when needed. As a result, the Budget Ways and Means Committee voted unanimously to recommend that the board approve the purchase for a cost not to exceed $92,000. Please note that this motion is for the purchase alone. Installation will be subject to competitive bid by electrical contractors prior to the anticipated delivery date. Please contact Director Mary Bednar or Township Engineer Scott Chabot for further information or questions concerning this recommendation. Respectfully, Paul Gillingham, Treasurer.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 11, pavement replacement cost and participation in agreement with MDOT on Gratiot Water Main Replacement Project.
Dear Board members, the water main related improvements for the Gratiot Water Main Replacement Project from Quinn Road to 15 Mile Road are completed. The CIPP lining work was completed at the end of December, and all required connections and services were reestablished by the end of January 2023. This work was all performed under the winter conditions based on scope change conditions presented to the Township Board on November 14th, 2023. These conditions required additional driveway pavement removals for the temporary water bypass system. Due to risk of freezing and damage from traffic, the driveways were open cut with the piping buried throughout the project duration. Removal of mainline locations of Gratiot were also needed to locate utilities due to locations not matching record information. With the impending Gratiot Avenue pavement rehabilitation project starting in early April 2023, the contractor presented AEW with pricing and pavement improvements under winter conditions. Upon evaluation of those unit prices, AEW reviewed those amounts versus the unit cost in the Gratiot Avenue road improvements. The overall cost for incorporating that work into the MDOT project was significantly lower than the contractor's winter pricing and their as-bid pricing. After meeting with MDOT and getting final quantities, a cost comparison was completed and is attached with this letter. MDOT has agreed to incorporate these pavement improvements in the project scope, and a copy of the agreement is included. Please note that some pavement removal and replacement in Gratiot Avenue, along with sidewalk work in winter conditions, were also necessary for project safety and to open Gratiot Avenue to traffic in the winter months. Those costs are outlined in the attached cost breakdown spreadsheet. The estimated cost of pavement improvements to be included in the MDOT project scope is $150,669.60. The additional required winter paving improvements in the amount of $56,750.80, additional pavement improvements outside MDOT right-of-way in the amount of $49,100, and items in charge order number 2 in the amount of $103,799.10 need to be added to the contract amount for Paymar Enterprises. Altogether, this results in a net increase of $360,319.50, or 22.9% in the project construction cost, from $1,570,865.25 to $1,931,184.75. Since the sum of these construction costs, it is incumbent to notify the Township Board of these necessary changes. Well, I'm sorry, I skipped a line. Since the sum of these contract modifications and MDOT construction costs are more than 10% of the previously approved construction costs, it is incumbent to notify the Township Board of these necessary changes and formally amend the budget project. Based upon the conditions noted above, we recommend that the Township Board approve the noted pavement restoration work to be performed by MDOT as part of their current road project and the additional work under the current construction contract defined herein. The total budgeted amount for this project will be amended from $1,828,851 to $2,140,314.88. Sincerely, Scott Chabot, Project Manager with AEW.
Mr. Chabot, anything to add? Pretty straightforward. Any questions of the board?
I do have a question. Mr. Chabot, I know that this project took some time to manage, and as a result, you know, winter months set in and prices changed dramatically, but 22.9%, that's a pretty big increase. Is that, I mean, was there just a misstep in, you know, projecting that far out, or was it because there was a delay that made it increase?
Well, I think it was a combination of the information that we had versus both record information. A lot of it meaning we had to go into Gratiot Avenue, which wasn't expected. So there's pavement there that we had to go into and remove and replace, and then coupled that with the winter conditions, so the costs were more at that time. And then also as noted in the letter, we had the temporary bypass for the water where we realized going into December and knowing that we still had probably work to do in January where we had to tie in everything before we could connect the services, there was a significant amount of pavement that we had, well, those driveways we had to cut open and then have to essentially replace. And the condition, a lot of those driveways were in such a state that there was, you know, even the surrounding pavement had to be replaced. So there's, you know, there's a decent amount that had to be included as part of that scope. And hence the reason why when we got the quote from the contractor, it made sense to then get in touch with MDOT and see how those prices compared. And as noted, yeah, that there was a, you know, pretty sizable increase, but could have been a lot higher if we would have had to follow what our contractor had at that given time. So, and then also even like utility locating, there's a couple where records show that the main was in the Greenbelt area. It actually ended up being one of them was like under Vermander. So there's a lot more pavement that we had to remove in that particular instance as well. So a lot of those things just added up to kind of where we're at. And I think, I mean, I can't speak to it because, you know, MDOT gave me an estimate on what, because it was really their quantities, but they did try to be conservative on this, so I don't expect it to be that high, but I wanted to at least take the numbers that they gave me, and they were confident that we should be within that amount for this additional work.
Mr. Cannon, I'd like to make a motion to support this scope change as well as payment, and just make the note that a lot of times I've heard some folks say that we don't invest in the South End, and I think that couldn't be further from the truth, and I think this is another example, one of many, where we do invest in the South End, and so important is the safety of our water and sanitary system, and I think this is a great priority for this board to focus on and make sure that the public knows that we do prioritize all of Clinton Township, and we don't want people to look at Clinton Township as though it's divided between a South End and a North End. It is truly not a community that we care about in its whole, and I think this is a good example of one of many examples that we
Thank
do
you.
That.
Further comments? Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Stay right there, Mr. Chabot. Item 12, request to approve amendment to Exhibit A map of Crown Castle Fiber LLC Metro Act permit.
Mr. Cannon, I had read this into the minutes at a previous board meeting, so I don't think I need to read
so
it again.
So at this time, as I've given in prior correspondence to the clerk's office and also Mr. Dolan and to DPS, Ms. Bednar, the request that came in for the Metro Act, the request, which was at March 29th, I believe, that came in, the exhibit map that was submitted was the exact same exhibit map that was approved by the board, I believe it was the 9th of January. So at this time, we had, and actually they did get back with me, and they're still looking into the matter, but to move forward, at least on this particular request, would be to postpone and see if, you know, at this point, if there's any further action that we need to take. Because right now, it's the exact same map that what we already approved.
So that's your request.
Mr. Cannon, if I may,
yes.
We conferred on this today, and Mr. Chabot did receive concurrence on that suggested course of action from the applicant. Basically, it appears as though the wrong map is attached to their application. So what's important for us is to have the correct map that shows what they're actually planning on installing. And so postponement would be in order.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes, of course.
Well, it's not a motion. I have no idea what you all are talking about.
Good, we'll postpone it then.
Good.
If someone can give me a subject matter here, this would be incredibly helpful to me.
Well, you know what? It does take a little bit of learning, but I would say these companies that do the work do
But what is
very,
the work?
Well,
it's a metro.
It would take more time than we have tonight to go through.
Well,
but they don't clean up and put things back in order the way they should. That is my biggest complaint about these companies. Scott, I know you've seen it, and I've complained before.
Well, just to add a little more clarification, but it's the private utility companies such as, in this case, it's Crown Castle. They do fiber optic installations. So as part of the
the state requirements through the, is that Michigan?
Metro Act.
Metro Act. It's regulated through the, is that the Michigan?
Public Service Commission.
Public Service Commission. So the Metro Act, they're required to submit to communities to get permits to install these utilities, and it's renewed every 5 years. But they also have, if they have the opportunity to amend those permits, but from time to time. And by when they do that, they have to come back to the with a new request for the township to, or the community to consider. So in this case, they've come actually a couple times within their 5 year permit period to amend. And the this instance, it's the same exact map that they that shows a routing map of what's above ground, below ground, and gives a like a mileage or a footage of how much that they're putting in. So when we reviewed that versus what was done in January, which was their last upgrade, there's no change. So was it a we're just asking them, is this something where, I know we sent back to all the documentation, do they have it? Or is it something where potentially they sent the, maybe by accident, the wrong map? So we're still looking into that matter. We got correspondence today that they did, and they understand if we do need to postpone, but they are still looking into it. And I even as of the next meeting, if they do find something that's, or they do have something that's newer, we would then bring it up for reconsideration.
And in the meantime, I will learn more about this.
But Trustee Masuzic, I would suggest that you talk to Mrs. Bednar.
Right.
She is an expert and will give you an earful. When you walk away, you'll know what you're talking about.
Okay. Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Can I just explain to the entire board? We do have a process, a business process, regarding this issue. So I'm given notice when these types of permits are requested. And we as a board have 45 days to address the issue. And so immediately I submit the request to our attorney, Jack Dolan, and Scott Chabot. And I also CC our director of DPS, Mary Bednar, so that we're all on the same page. And then it's incumbent upon them to look at all the details of the request and that permit, and then do their due diligence, and then they bring that to the board and I put it on the agenda. So that's the process. I can forward it to you. It's actually in written format as well. So it gives you a little bit more familiarity with what a Metro Act is and why we have to do it. So it's not just the state of these private companies having obligations to the state of Michigan. We also have an obligation that we have to comply with within a parameter of time. So it's important that we're aware of all these things. And then it's very important that as changes take place, even if their change is not to change, that it's brought to the board's attention so that we can make sure we are addressing it, so that if any companies of these private companies wanted to say, oh, you didn't get it done in time or whatever, we can now say, yes, we did address these issues at the time when necessary. So we are in compliance.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Cannon.
And truly give her a call.
Mr. Cannon. And after that brief description from both of them, if you still have questions, feel free to call.
I would.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, no, they should. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, we have a motion and a support.
I'll second it. I don't believe we have a second. I'll second it. Okay.
Roll call.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Matuszak.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 13 is something that many people are experiencing, many businesses, including Clinton Township. We can't buy things as quickly as we would like to. We can't order them and expect them to be delivered in a timely fashion. We had an opportunity to purchase a fire vehicle, and that's what item 13 is, because some other community backed out of the purchase. So, Clerk Meltzer.
Honorable board members, I'm ready to request approval for the purchase of a new staff vehicle at a cost of $46,644. It is a 2023 Ford F-150 Super Crew Police Responder Package. This was a budgeted item, and it came in significantly under budget using the My Deal vendor contract list, Longhammer Ford, formerly Signature Ford, and the government pricing. There will be some additional costs such as lettering, emergency lighting, et cetera, but the overall price will stay within what was budgeted for. While we have normally used Ford Explorers in the past, the water department stated that the F-150s are much easier to work on and obtain parts for them. We are fortunate to have this opportunity to purchase this vehicle as we were initially finding that no government purchases would be available to us through both Chevrolet and Ford for 2023 due to supply chain issues. Thank you for your attention to this matter. Respectfully, Timothy Duncan, Fire Chief.
Thank you. This came as a pleasant surprise to the chief.
Yeah.
Is there a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve.
So I'll support.
Thank you. Comments? Roll call, please.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 14 is only on the agenda because we have a policy of out-of-state travel coming before the Township Board.
So moved to approve.
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Thank you. Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 15, request to approve professional service agreement for the environmental assessment and studies for the Clinton River Watershed Trail Improvements.
Dear Board members, on April 17th, 2023, the Charter Township of Clinton's Clerk's Office received and processed a total of two proposals for professional service for the above reference project. These proposals are for an environmental assessment and associated environmental studies that are required for the federally funded community project funding grant through the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, or HUD. The Assistant Planning Director, Director of Public Services and AEW reviewed the proposals with the respective consulting firms. Both firms provided sufficient information to validate that they have the necessary qualifications, personnel, and experience to conduct the specialized environmental assessment and associated environmental study work. Our review team unanimously agreed to proceed with recommending ASTI Environmental for these specialized professional services. On behalf of the Clinton Township Planning Department and the Department of Public Services, along with the conditions noted above, we recommend that a professional services agreement for the environmental assessment and studies for the federally funded Clinton River Water Trail Project be awarded to ASTI Environmental, located at 10448 Citation Drive, Suite 100, Brighton, Michigan, 48226, in the amount of $72,000. Sincerely, Scott Chabot, Project Manager for AEW.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Thank you. Through the chair to Mr. Chabot, why are these $30,000 apart?
These professional services?
Yeah, these bids. ASTI, we just started working with, right? From a couple other recent projects?
No, actually, it was the firm. It was ETC is doing the other two environmental studies.
ETC, okay.
So they're doing the for Webster Park and also for Joy Park.
Okay.
Now this one here is a lot more involved. My guess is I know that ASTI was able to do a lot of the work in-house, and ETC I think had to utilize other subconsultants, so there could be some cost incorporated in there. So that would be my professional opinion or guess on that.
So in reviewing the bids, though, nothing stood out to you as to be worried why one, you know, again would be so much more than the other.
No, and actually the amount that was quoted was from a previous, when they submitted, was the same amount.
Okay.
From a previous quote as well. So we had to rebid it, but their price stayed consistent.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I'll make a motion for approval.
Is there support?
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have item 16 to go into closed session, and we will be coming out of closed session for contract negotiations.
So moved.
Support.
Supported by Mrs. West. Roll call, please.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes.
Thank you. We have two public comments this evening. Mr. Sam Bichelle.
And at the last Planning Commission meeting, and a couple before that, actually, the Planning Director made clear that the Township Board can and has approved the glut of site plans that do not meet our ordinances. With this being a constant problem, why are we spending more tax dollars to revise the zoning ordinance? Is it to water down our protections? The planner noted the ordinances will outlaw chain link fences topped with barbed wire and vinyl slats that the board has seemed to set as a new standard for required screening that as of today requires masonry walls, actually. The current ordinance requires paved storage with a building, but the board approved the first dirt storage lot on Grosbeck with no building or any other required amenities with chain link fence with vinyl slats just recently. Why pay for more updates when you have violated the current ordinance repeatedly? The public service director stated in the case on Lipke as fact that all site plans for the last 20 years plus have required a stormwater covenant that she has not had to enforce in the past 20 years. In fact, my FOIA request to examine the stormwater covenant on Consumer Energy's recently approved 22-acre plus site showed no such covenant or even a required drainage system. Why spend more when the current laws are not enforced on the largest site plan approved in many, many years? Save our tax dollars and home values by following the laws you have sworn to uphold, not pay for new laws. In the case of why Consumer Energy doesn't have a stormwater plan, you all can drive through that multi-acre parking lot that's brand new that was built just here recently, and you'll find there are no drains. And there's already been a problem there. In fact, you can see the spot where they had to chemically clean off where a truck ran into one of the new light poles that are illegal and with the problem it caused for our neighborhood. I'm not sure why. I'm sure he's looking for the 3 minutes, so I'm going to say, I am glad to see that when other people came up here before they were asked to, they did not have to be told, oh, you can't come up until you're allowed. And this is that's what this board does. You treat people very, very differently. Thank you.
We live in a great country. The second speaker is Sue Deliberti.
Susan Deliberti, 41202 Worthington. I spoke a couple weeks ago, and it was about the whole process about Unity Park and how that came about. I've done some research after that day. I don't even know when that was. 2 months ago, I had a knee replacement. All kinds of things happened. So I wanted to talk a little bit about Columbus Day and how it came about. But before I do that, I want to say just simply that Columbus is not really a good representative of our Italian-American community, as we just saw, the people that were in here. Just want to put that out front. The 1891 New Orleans lynchings, you may have heard of this, were the murders of 11 Italian-Americans and immigrants in New Orleans by a mob for their alleged role in the murder of police chief David Hennessy after some of them had been acquitted at a trial. It was the largest single mass lynching in American history. As disturbing as that is, there were 4,467 total victims of lynching from 1883 to 1941. Of these victims, 4,027 were men, 99 were women, 341 were of unidentified gender, although likely male. 3,265 were black, 1,082 were white, 71 were Mexican or of Mexican descent, 38 were African Indian, or American Indian, 10 were Chinese, and 1 was Japanese. The incident in New Orleans, back to that.
And you have 1 minute.
I just wanted to put it in context. I have 1 minute? Mm-hmm. The incident in New Orleans had serious national repercussions. The Italian consul in New Orleans registered a protest and left the city. Italy cut off diplomatic relations with the United States, sparking rumors of war. increased anti-Italian sentiment led to calls for restrictions on immigration. As part of an effort to ease tensions with Italy and placate Italian Americans, President Benjamin Harrison declared the first national celebration of Columbus Day in 1892, commemorating the 400th anniversary of the Italian explorer landing in the New World. This strikes me very ironic that Columbus Day was established to appease lynchings, and they used to commemorate Columbus, who basically helped initiate the slave trade, which led to lynchings. And do you get where I'm coming from? Mm-hmm.
Your time is up. Thank you.
My last thing is I needed to find out
your time is up.
How do I contact the person
Mr.
Unity Park?
Mr. Dominic Mascheri.
Okay, I just wanted information about who I contact.
Mr. Dominic
about
Mascheri.
Unity Park. Thank you.
That's who you contact. We're going to go into closed session. We will be coming back into open session. Thank you. We'll call the meeting back to order. Mr. Smith.
Mr. Cannon, I am recommending the board approve the labor agreement between AFSCME 1917.31, mid-managers, and the township. It is a five-year agreement with 12% spread over the 5 years, the establishment of a defined contribution pension plan, and changes to overtime and standby pay procedures.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion for approval.
Support.
Support of Julie. And Mr. Smith, on behalf of the board, and I know we all feel the same way, you've done a great job with all the negotiation. You're almost done. So we'll look forward to 2 weeks from now and finishing some more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak.
Yes.
Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. A motion to adjourn is in order.
So moved.
Support.
Did you say something, Mike?
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer? Yes.
Thank you. Meeting adjourned. Thank you all.